In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
I'm going to do something today I hope that I very seldom do. And, I'm going to deliver you a message that I've preached here before. I preached this, the title of the same message here just a little under 30 years ago. So if there's somebody here that was here when I preached it before, and if this is boring to you to hear this story again, I apologize, but I hope that even if you've heard it before, that you will not find it uninteresting, because it is a biblical story. And I've entitled it the same as I entitled it before, Joseph's Three Coats. And before we look at Joseph's Three Coats, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to read from his holy book. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be in your house on your holy day, and that now as we open your holy word and try to understand what we read, we earnestly pray that you'll be our teacher and that you'll impart to us that spiritual knowledge that we need to understand from your word to be ready for the future. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you have your Bible, I invite you to open it to Genesis 37. Genesis 37, verse 3. It says, "Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age." By the way, Jacob was 91 years old when Joseph was born. "Because he was the son of his old age, also he made him a tunic of many colors." Now, Jacob made a mistake, a very serious mistake. He gave Joseph preferential treatment over all his other children. And this type of evil is still prevalent all over the world. And children are very quick to understand when other children are either the black sheep of the family or the father's favorite. And by the way, it is very difficult for parents to avoid doing this. If one child is obedient, respectful, industrious, thoughtful, godly — Joseph was all of those things — and another child is cruel, like Simeon and Levi, or impure, like Judah and Reuben, it's very difficult for a parent to treat the children the same in a situation like that. But either making one child the black sheep of the family or making another child the favorite can have lifelong dangerous consequences. It can have unfortunate consequences to both the child that is the black sheep in the family and the child that is the favored child in the family. Both of those children can be damaged as a result of that type of treatment. By the way, I've lived long enough to see this play out in people's lives. And it goes all the way to the end of their life. It's a lifelong effect. Now, the root cause of the trouble in Jacob's family was, of course, the fact that he was practicing polygamy. He was married to two sisters. Now, Jacob's practice of polygamy was something that he was tricked into. It wasn't something that he decided he was going to do. It was something he was tricked into. First of all, by Laban. And later, his two wives made his situation even worse by adding two more wives to his family. What would it be like to be married to four women? You want to read it from the Bible, what it's like to be married to four women? Let's just read it. This is later in Jacob's life, and he is now talking to Pharaoh. And this is in Genesis 47 and verse 9. The days of the years of my pilgrimage are 130 years. Few and evil have been the days of the years of my life. That's the way he described his life. Few and evil. Of course, his trouble really started when he tried to take advantage of his brother and eventually lied to his father to get the birthright. And these types of stories have occurred millions of times. And when Jesus was here, as a result of 4,000 years of practice of polygamy and divorce and remarriage, the situation in society had gotten so bad, even among God's professed people, that there were some of the leaders of God's professed people that said that it was all right to divorce for any cause. They actually taught that. Some of the Jewish rabbis taught that it was all right to get a divorce for any cause. And they proved it from the Bible, by the way. It's always interesting to me when people prove their false doctrines from the Bible. Do you want to see how you prove that from the Bible? Go back to Deuteronomy 24. It says, Deuteronomy 24, verses 1 to 4. When a man takes a wife and marries her, and it happens that she finds no favor in his eyes because he has found some uncleanness in her, and he writes her a certificate of divorce, puts it in her hand, and sends her out of his house. When she has departed from his house and goes and becomes another man's wife, if the latter husband detests her and writes her a certificate of divorce, puts it in her hand, and sends her out of his house, or if the latter husband dies who took her to be his wife, then her former husband who divorced her must not take her back to be his wife after she has been defiled. For that is an abomination before the Lord, and you shall not bring sin on the land which the Lord your God has given you as an inheritance. Now notice, under the old covenant, a man was allowed to have more than one wife, and he was allowed to divorce his wife, but there were still some lines. The Lord said, if you do divorce your wife and marry somebody else, and she marries somebody else, later in your life, you are not to come back to the original wife again. That's an abomination. Now, it's an amazing thing to me that with all of our understanding of advanced theology today, that right in Adventism, we have people that will do the very thing that under the old covenant you were never allowed to do. Under the old covenant, you were allowed to practice polygamy and you were allowed to have a divorce and remarriage, but you were not allowed after you had separated and married others to come back to the original again. And we have people doing that today. But this situation had gotten so evil and so serious that when Jesus came, the members of the Godhead said, this has gone too far and has to be corrected. Jesus came to correct many things in human society. You aware of that? And polygamy was one of them. And divorce was another one. And so Jesus corrected the practices of his children that they had been following under the old covenant. And Jesus was very clear on this point. If you look in Matthew 19, there's some people today that still want to be under the old covenant instead of the new covenant. And it says here in Matthew 19, starting with the third verse, it says, "The Pharisees also came to him, testing him and saying to him, 'Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason?'" That's what some of the rabbis were teaching, and other rabbis said, no, you shouldn't be able to do that for just anything. There should be more stringent regulations on when you can get a divorce. And so they came to test Jesus with this question: can a man get a divorce for any reason? Verse 4, he answered and said to them, "Have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female? And said, 'For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh.' So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate." What is that? What do you read? What do you understand from verse 6? This is the Lord of glories. This is the majesty of heaven speaking. What do you understand from verse 6? This is a direct divine command not to get a divorce. Is that the way you understand it? What God has joined together, let not man separate. Don't do something that God said not to do. If your spouse decides to do it, that's one thing. But you, if you're a Christian, you don't do it. Notice what it says in verse 7. They started to argue with him. They said to him, "Why then did Moses command to give a certificate of divorce and to put her away?" We just read the verses in Deuteronomy 24. Notice what Jesus answered. He said to them, "Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts under the old covenant, they were allowed to do many things that were not God's will for them. They were allowed to do it because of the hardness of their hearts." Because of the hardness of their hearts, the prophet said the Lord gave them laws that were not good. Not because that's what he wanted, but because of the hardness of their hearts, they were allowed to do things that were not good. I preached a whole series of sermons on this subject, by the way, in 1995, not on divorce, but on the whole subject of hardness of heart. I did a lot of research on this in 1995. I did a lot of research on this subject, hardness of heart. Are you aware of the fact that no hard-hearted person will be in the kingdom of heaven? Are you aware of that? No hard-hearted person will be in the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus said, Moses allowed you to do these things because your hearts were hard. You can't go to heaven that way. Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, permitted you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it was not so. Did God intend for Adam to ever get a divorce from Eve? No, he didn't. By the way, we've studied this before. God's plan, God's order for marriage is clearly spelled out in the second chapter of Genesis. When God created the world, he made one man and one woman. He did not give Adam the opportunity to be married to another man. There wasn't another man. He did not give Eve the opportunity to be married to another woman. There wasn't another woman. Clearly spelled out in the book of Genesis, he made one man and one woman, and he ordained for that man and that woman to be married. And it's all spelled out in Genesis, the second chapter. That is God's plan. And Jesus said, "What God has joined together, let not man put asunder." Verse 9, "And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for a sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery, and whoever marries her who is divorced commits adultery." Well, the disciples are so astonished, they said, "Oh, it's that bad, it'd be better not to even get married." Because they grew up in a society where divorce was allowed. Well, the Bible is very clear. God made one man, one woman, and they are two to be joined together, and they too says the same. Jesus said that in Matthew 19. Paul said the same thing in Ephesians 5:31. They too. One man, one woman. They too. Not they three. Or they four, like it was in Jacob's. Within Jacob's situation, it was they five. That was not God's plan. And my friends, whenever we wander away from God's perfect plan, there are always consequences. There's always results that happen. And this story we're going to study, the foundation or origin of the story of the trouble was polygamy, Jacob having more than one wife. That was the origin, that was the foundation of the whole problem. So you have a situation where you have two sisters that are married to the same man, so they're competing with one another. Now, we're not going to take too much time to read all this, but you can go back to Genesis 30 and 31, and when Naphtali was born, do you know why he received the name Naphtali? Because Rachel said, I've had a great struggles fighting with my sister, and the Lord has helped me to prevail. So she named him Naphtali. Just read the names of the different children that Jacob had. Almost every single one of them is named, and it has to do with the mother's desire to come into more favor with Jacob than the other women. So you have all these women competing with one another. Now, the children in a situation like this, the children know. You cannot deceive your children as to what's really going on in your house. If the father and mother are fighting all the time in their bedroom, do you think the children know about that? They do. The children perceive what is going on. So do you think that the children understood? Did the children know which wife Jacob really loved? Did they know that? Of course they knew that. The Bible says, by the way, that Rachel was loved and Leah was hated. And it's a terrible thing. It's a terrible thing to be married to somebody and the person you're married to you hates you. And you can understand how and why it was, because the Bible tells you how that got to be. So you have all these different brothers. They're not really all full-blood brothers or all half-brothers. They have different mothers. And you can understand how there will be lots of quarrels and lots of fights among these brothers. Can't you understand that? Isn't that easy to understand? There'll be a lot of fighting between these different brothers. A lot of strife, which there was. But of all the brothers, Joseph became a special target by the brothers because everybody knew, all the children knew, that Rachel was Jacob's favorite wife. All the children knew that. All the children knew that Joseph was Rachel's firstborn son. Now, in their society, you know this. What special privileges did a firstborn son have? The firstborn son got the birthright. You read about that? And the birthright. Well, first of all, let's suppose that there's multiple children. And so when the father dies, the estate would be divided up equally among the children, except the one that got the birthright got a double portion. Now, there were responsibilities, of course, that went along with getting the birthright. The oldest son who received the birthright, he got a double portion of the wealth, but there were responsibilities that went along with that. The oldest son then became financially responsible for the welfare of his mother and all the women in the family and all the other children in the family. He, He had to take the father's place in being financially responsible for everybody in the family. So it wasn't a bad idea, of course, for him to get a double portion of the wealth, so she was going to have more responsibility than anybody else. But in this situation, you can understand how the brothers got jealous, because they said, Reuben is really the firstborn. But Jacob is going to, look at what he did. He made Joseph this special coat. He's going to give Joseph the birthright, and he's going to make him the ruler over all of us. And so notice what it says in Genesis 37:4. Genesis 37:3. Now in verse 4, it says, But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. They hated him. They couldn't speak peaceably to him. And then, of course, you read down further in the chapter, Joseph had some dreams, and he told them the dreams. They hated him even more. And notice what it says in Genesis 37, verse 11. It says, his brothers envied him. Joseph had this coat of many colors, and this coat of many, by the way, it's just always true in this world. We all do this. If you think you're exception, please tell me after the service if you're exception to this universal human rule. We judge people according to their appearance. We just do that. When I was, Melville and I were in North Dakota, I was a conference pastor in Grand Forks, North Dakota for several years, and when we were there, we were living in a conference-owned home. We were living in a parsonage, and this parsonage was in Grand Forks, North Dakota, on the south side of town, and about three blocks from the parsonage where we lived, there was a big shopping mall, and in that shopping mall, now this was several decades ago, in this shopping mall, there was a Sears and Roebuck store, and Sears in those days was a very prosperous, one of the largest retailers in the United States. And back in those days, if you're working on your car, which I did, if you needed anything, gaskets, rings, valves, a water pump, fuel pump, tires, anything you needed for your car, you could get it at Sears. They had everything for cars. They were just like an auto parts store back in those days. And so I'd be working my car, so I need something. Well, it was so quick to go over there, just go over there three blocks away, and you could get what you need to come back. But I found something interesting. I had gone to Sears a few times when I had been changing the oil in my car, and I found something, needed something, and I went over there in my work clothes. But then another time, I was a preacher, so there were other times when I had occasion to go in that same place when I had a suit and a tie on. I found out something very interesting. It was the same store. It was the same clerks. But when I walked in there and I had been changing the oil in my car and I was into my grubby work clothes, they didn't even know I was there. I had to go find out whatever I wanted, and then I had to go up to the counter, to the cashier, and pay for it. But if I walked in that store, same clerk, same place, I walked in there with a suit and a tie on. As soon as I walked in the door, a clerk came up to me and said, May I help you, sir? Soon as they'd help me find whatever I wanted, they would take me up and give me preferential treatment and get me through the cashier, and I was out. I said, I'm never coming here in my work clothes again. From every time I go downtown to shop, I'm going to see that I have a suit on and a tie. Tie makes a huge difference, by the way, how you get treated. And God knows all about that. Do you remember what the Lord said to Samuel when Samuel was looking over Jesse's sons, and the first one, he says, was a real tall young man? He thought, oh, this is the one. The Lord said, no, that's not the one. And what did the Lord tell Samuel on that time? You remember this in 1 Samuel 16. Do you remember what the Lord told Samuel that time? Exactly. He says, man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. That's what I found out. I found that was true when I lived in North Dakota. Man looks on the outward appearance, Lord looks in the heart, and Joseph had this coat that this was the type of a coat that only people of distinction, people that were important, wore. And that's what made his brothers so angry. They didn't have one like that. They weren't dressed like that. And so we just read it in Genesis 37:11. They envied Joseph. Is envy serious? My dear friends, envy, I said to you already, nobody will enter the kingdom of heaven who is hard-hearted, but neither will anyone enter the kingdom of heaven who is a victim of envy. Let's just read a few texts in the Bible so you see how serious envy is. Look in the book of Romans. Romans, the first chapter. Look at verse 29. It says, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy. Okay, it mentions a whole bunch of other things. But then it says in verse 32, knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death. How serious is envy? Worthy of death. It's a person that's filled with envy is worthy of death. 1 Corinthians 13:4 says, love does not envy. Envy will keep you out of heaven. What did his brothers decide to do as a result of their envy? Well, look at what envy will do to you. Look here in Genesis 38:17. Genesis 37:18. When they saw him afar off, even before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him. That's what envy will do. We don't have time now, right now, to go into this in detail, but study it out for yourself. In heaven, Lucifer envied Christ. And what did that lead him to do eventually? To murder the Son of God. Joseph was a type of Christ. His brothers envied him, and they decided they were going to murder him, but God intervened. So they didn't actually murder him, but they sold him as a slave. So Joseph's first coat brought to him the first major disaster in his life. In one day, his coat was taken from him. He was changed from the position of a son of a wealthy cattleman to a slave in a foreign country, having lost all family and friends. I often think of Job when I study the story of Joseph. Job went through an experience like this where he went from a very prosperous, wealthy, respected person in a matter of days. Everybody despised him. Job says, the people that I wouldn't even associate with, they spit in my face. And yet, we're all tempted, if we have any kind of prosperity in this world, we are tempted to trust in our worldly prosperity. The Bible gives us many, many warnings about this. Joseph understood this. You can lose everything that you have of a worldly character, of a worldly nature. You can lose it in a day. The Bible says the riches take wings and fly away. That's what it says in Proverbs 23:5. It says in Proverbs 11:4 that riches do not profit in the day of wrath. It says in Proverbs 11:28 that the person who trusts in his riches will fall. It says in Proverbs 27:24 that riches are not forever. What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Well, Joseph's first coat brought him the first great disaster of his life. But his second coat brought him the second great disaster of his life. Let's read about that. Look in Genesis 39. starting verse 7. Now it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast longing eyes on Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Look, my master does not know what is with me in the house, and he has committed all that he has to my hand. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" So it was, as she spoke to him, Joseph, day by day, that he did not heed her to lie with her or to be with her. But it happened about this time, when Joseph went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was inside, that she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and ran outside. And so it was, when she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and fled outside, that she called to the men of her house and spoke to them, saying, "See, he has brought in to us a Hebrew to mock us. He came in to me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And it happened when he heard that I lifted my voice and cried out that he left his garment with me and fled and went outside." So she kept his garment with her until his master came home. Then she spoke to him with words like these, saying, "The Hebrew servant whom you brought in to us came in to me to mock me. So it happened, as I lifted my voice and cried out, that he left his garment with me and fled outside." So it was when his master heard the words which his wife spoke to him, saying, "Your servant did to me after this manner," that his anger was aroused. Then Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in the prison. In one day, again, he went from being a manager of an important person in Egypt to prison, lost everything. The first time, with the first coat, he lost his family and became a slave. Now he's elevated again to be a manager, and now he loses his second coat. His master's wife grabs it from him. He runs out. He gets away from there. She keeps it. So see what? She uses that as evidence to get him put in jail, put in prison. So his second coat, the coat he was wearing that Potiphar's wife grabbed and he ran out and left it with her, that brought him to the second great disaster in his life. Now, not only is this a slave, now he's in prison and he has no earthly way to ever get out of prison, and he'll be there the rest of his life. By the way, the reason I emphasize this, maybe there's somebody listening and you're in a situation that is impossible unless the Lord works in your behalf. Joseph was in a situation that was humanly impossible. There was no way out. He was there for the rest of his life, and there was no way to, there was nothing he could do. And by the way, prisoners know which prisoners are there often because of a crime they committed, and which prisoners are there on false charges. Prisoners know that. I've been involved in prison ministry enough years to know. One time I was in a prison ministry there, in non-denominational prison ministry in Texas. I went to the Tarrant County Jail in Fort Worth, Texas every week for a long time. One time I was sent up to, they had different kind of cells. Sometimes they sent us to a cell where there'd be 15 or 20 people in a cell, and then there'd be individual little rooms where they'd lock them at night, but the daytime they'd be out in this bigger area. But this time I was sent to a place where in the area there was only two men. And one of them wasn't interested in talking anything about religion, but the other one was. And so I was talking to this gentleman, and he told me, we're going to run out of time. I can't tell you all the details of this story. I'll tell you real quick. This man told me, he said, "I'm here accused of capital murder." But he said, "I didn't do it." The girl that had been stabbed to death, he knew this girl, and he had been in this girl's home, and they had been visiting the very night that she was murdered. But he told me, "I didn't do it, but I was in the home, and so they got my fingerprints because I was in the home visiting with her, but I didn't do it, and the person, whoever did it, that person's free. They're not even looking for him because they think I did it, but I didn't do it. Well, I had nothing to say. But there have been millions and millions of people down through the ages who have been put in prison and been many, many years in prison, sometimes on false charges. Joseph was in prison, by the way, for a period of years. It looks like he was in prison about 3 years. 3 long years. Here's what the Bible says about it. Look in your Bible at Psalm 105. Psalm 105. It says in verse 18, they hurt his feet with fetters. He was laid in irons, as Joseph's talked about. Joseph's not the only person that had that experience. Notice what Paul says about it in Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11, 36. Says, still others had trial of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains and imprisonment. Anybody here that is suffering? Anybody that you feel like you are suffering a suffering that is undeserved? Did Joseph feel that he was suffering something that he didn't deserve? Of course he did. He knew he didn't deserve what was happening. He knew he was in there as a result of the lies that this lady had told on him. By the way, that's happened millions of times. It's happened in the United States. It's been in the news. There was a man, I think, in Illinois that was in prison for a number of years and was finally released because the woman who got him in prison confessed that she'd been lying. If you are in that kind of a situation, no doubt you are tempted to become bitter and revengeful. That's the devil's way to try to get you to be lost too. People in prison who believe that they are being punished unjustly or to an unjust extent are tempted to become revengeful, bitter against everybody. Some years ago, I think this was in Texas, there were some people in prison that felt that the judge that had sentenced them unjustly. They were so angry. They became so angry about it, they decided when they got out of prison that they would rather go back into prison in order to have their revenge. And so when they got out of prison, they went and got firearms. They went to that judge's house and shot him. Of course, then they probably had to spend the rest of their life in prison, but they had that feeling of revenge. And that's what happens when people feel like they're suffering unjustly, something they haven't deserved. The devil tempts them to become bitter. By the way, God cannot take the bitter person to heaven either. And that's the devil's goal, to help you to become bitter so that you can't be saved either. The Bible has a lot to say about this. Look in Romans 12. Starting with verse 17, repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it be as possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy hungers, feed him. If he thirsts, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And my dear friends, let me just mention this quickly. Some of the hardest people for other people to forgive are the people in their own family. You just check me out on that. Some of the hardest people to forgive are the people that have wronged you in your own family. But notice what Jesus said. Matthew 18, 35. It says, so my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother their trespasses. Forgiveness, by the way, is expensive. in order for us to be forgiven of what we have done, the only way that we could be permanently forgiven for what we have done is for Jesus Christ to come to this world and as a human being and to die on the cross. That's the only way that forgiveness could happen. Ellen White says that someday when we're in heaven, we are going to find out that our Heavenly Father, who is infinite in wisdom, could find no other way to redeem the human race, to give them forgiveness, except by the sacrifice of His Son. Forgiveness is expensive. It was expensive for Jesus. It will be expensive for you. It will be expensive for me. But Jesus said, if you want to be forgiven, then you have to forgive. Many texts in the Bible, we could read about that. If you want to read one, read Colossians 3:13. We're running out of time. Let's take a look at Joseph's third coat. Turn to Genesis 41. Genesis 41, verse 42. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring off his hand and put it on Joseph's hand, and he clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. Notice, now Joseph is wearing a royal robe, a royal coat. In fact, it says he is wearing garments of fine linen. Do you know what fine linen represents in the Bible? Let's just read it. Go to your Bible, Revelation 19. Revelation 19. Verses 7 and 8, let us be glad and rejoice and give Him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His wife has made herself ready, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in what? Fine linen. Fine linen is a symbol of the wedding garment. Fine linen was what was used for royal apparel. That's what Joseph got. His third coat was fine linen, royal apparel. To her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. The third garment, the third coat that Joseph had, is symbolic of what the King of Heaven is going to give to His children. His first coat he got from his earthly father. That just got him in trouble. His second coat he got from Potiphar, and that just got him in more trouble. But his third coat he got from the king, symbolic of the robe of righteousness, the wedding garment that God is going to give to all of His children. Joseph did not earn this third coat. He was given this third coat. You cannot earn this coat either. But it is something. Notice what it says here in Revelation 19, 7 and 8. It says, to her it was granted. In other words, she was given this. This is not something that you can earn. Not something you can pay for. It's only something that the King of Heaven can give you. And remember what it represents. The fine linen represents something. We read it in Revelation 19, 8. What does the fine linen, the wedding garment, the robe of righteousness, what does it represent? It represents the righteousness, the righteous acts of the saints. All of the righteousness that we have, the Bible says, is as filthy rags. You can read that in Isaiah 64. But God wants to take the filthy rags off of you. Let's read that. Look in Zechariah, the third chapter. Zechariah 3, 4. Then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, see, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you in rich robes. What does it mean to have your filthy garments removed? It means to have your iniquity taken away. And what does it mean to be clothed with the royal robe? It means to be clothed in the robe of Christ's righteousness. Let's think that through for just a moment. Can I be clothed in the robe of Christ's righteousness if I am living a life of sin? No, I have to stop that if I'm going to be clothed in the robe of Christ's righteousness. My iniquity has to be taken away. My iniquity can't be taken away if I'm still doing it. Does that make sense? The prophets talk about this over and over again. We read it in our scripture. If you turn back to Isaiah, we'll read a few verses from our scripture again. Look in Isaiah 52, verse 1. It says, "Awake, awake, put on your strength, O Zion, put on your what? Put on your beautiful garments." When you put on the beautiful garments, then you're to keep them clean, because it says in verse 11, "Touch no unclean thing." Put on the beautiful garments, touch no unclean thing. This is what it talks about. This is the warning, the instruction of Jesus for those that are living in the very end of time. Look in Revelation 16. Now, this is a chapter that describes the pouring out of the seven last plagues. And as it's describing the pouring out of the seven last plagues, when it talks about the sixth plague and about Armageddon, the great battle, that great day of Almighty, when the world itself is going, when everybody that's not saved is going to end up getting destroyed. Notice what it says here, right in the middle when it's talking about the pouring out of the seven last plagues. Notice what it says in verse 15, Isaiah 16, verse 15. It says, "Behold, I am coming as a thief." This is Jesus speaking. "Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments." What garments is Jesus talking about? He's talking about this fine linen. Remember, Joseph was clothed in fine linen, given him by the king. He's clothed in fine linen, royal garments. Fine linen is a symbol of the royal garment, the wedding garment. And Jesus said, "Watch, keep your garments clean. Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame." My dear friend, when Jesus comes back to this earth again, the only thing that's going to matter, the only thing that's going to matter is, do you have the wedding garment on? That's all that's going to matter. Nothing else will matter then. Whatever you gained or lost, whatever trouble you have, whatever success or failure, anything you had, nothing will matter except that one thing. You have the wedding garment on? If you have the wedding garment on, you'll be able to go the marriage supper. If you don't have the wedding garment on, we won't take time now to read it. It's in Matthew 22 where Jesus explained this in verses 1 to 14. If you don't have the wedding garment on, you will not be allowed inside. You'll be cast out. You'll be bound hand and foot, it says, and cast out. Are you going to have the wedding garment on? Look at Revelation 3, verse 5. "He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments." That's the wedding garment. "And I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels." Let me ask you a question. Even if you're a Christian, can your name be blotted out of the book of life? Yes, it can. But Jesus said, if you overcome, then your name will not be blotted out of the book of life. Back for just a moment at Isaiah 61. Isaiah 61. This chapter contains some verses about the wedding garment that I personally am trying to understand. I'm not telling you I understand it yet, but I'm trying to learn about it and understand about it. Look, for instance, at verse 3. It says, "To console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. The wedding garment is a garment of praise. The people with the wedding garment on are not going around complaining and bickering and all that sort of thing. They're praising the Lord, even when they're in trouble. That's interesting to study. Here's one more text, and we're going to stop. This is verse 10. This is about rejoicing and praising too. It says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. This is a garment. You cannot earn it. You cannot make it. But it can be given to you. And if you surrender your will, your heart, your life to the Lord, he will give it to you. You can't make it. You can't earn it. But he can give it to you. What that means is, let me try to explain it simply. It means that the Holy Spirit implants the nature of Jesus Christ into my central nervous system so that I become an incarnation of Jesus Christ again. Did you know it is God's will for his church to be a reincarnation of Jesus Christ? That's what God's will is for everyone who calls himself a Christian. Do you want to have that experience? So you can say, Lord, you have clothed me with the garment of salvation. You have clothed me with a robe of righteousness. He's the only one that can do that. But if you surrender your life totally to him, to follow him, to obey him, to do his will do it. He never fails to do it for those that are fully surrendered to him. That's why Jesus said to Nicodemus, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. Why will he have everlasting life? Because the Lord will clothe him with a garment of righteousness, robe of righteousness, the garment of salvation. You want to have this experience in your life? This is what we have to be ready for Jesus to come. Let's pray that it'll happen in our life. Father in heaven, we thank you that you have provided to cover our nakedness with a robe that is a royal robe of fine linen, pure, bright, and clean. And you have promised that you will remove our filthy rags from us. Lord, we pray that as we choose now to surrender our life to the sovereignty of Jesus Christ, that we might receive his robe, his character, his way of thinking, speaking, acting, his way of living. We pray that the Holy Spirit may implant in our heart that eternal seed, that robe of righteousness, that will be what we need to have on when Jesus comes. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.